Hello, David.
Hello. Hey, Jeremy.
How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. I'm looking forward to this conversation.
I have been as well. I guess I have a few questions I could start off by asking you. And you could take them in either order or pick one. The first one is more one that just comes to mind talking with different people about different ways of detecting life or life-like complexity or how to define complexity. And that is there a rigorous way, do you think, of, or at least a more rigorous way than my hand-waving, which is where I usually have to leave off in making this point, of trying to claim that if you make something good at one thing, that it's more likely to be better at something else than if you didn't try to make it to be good at something at all. So to put it a little more precisely, if I have a collection of pieces and I'm going to put them together in some way and I'm going to try to optimize them so that they accomplish a task or that they're extremely, exceptionally good at something that I decide, then after I do that, after I find some optimum or at least extremized assembly of those pieces, should I expect that it'll be easier to repurpose it? Should I expect that being good at one thing makes you more likely to be good at multiple things? Or is that not an easy intuition or not an easy something to make more rigorous?
It's very interesting. And I think that here's what I would suggest. It's been our experience, given our unique intelligence, but it's absolutely not been the experience of machine intelligence. Mm-hmm. So, which perhaps points to why they're fundamentally distinct. I mean, so just to clarify, you know this, but you know, this is the problem with the original AlphaGo, AlphaZero reinforcement learning algorithm that DeepMind built, which was that when they played it with a Go board that was no longer the regular dimensions of 19 by 19, increase it or decrease it to another odd number, it immediately failed, right? It was a dreadful player. And most famously with Breakout, when they taught their deep learning network Breakout, and then they shunted the bat down a pixel, and it just fell apart. Mm-hmm. So that's a case of system that's extraordinarily good at something, but mm-hmm. is awful at being repurposed. In other words, it mm-hmm. doesn't show any transfer learning at all, right? Mm-hmm. And whereas humans, it's true, we seem to have almost the opposite capability. And with mathematics in particular, it has exactly that quality. And in fact, we might even demand that of our tools, right? That mm-hmm. what good is a hammer that you can only use to hang up one kind of photograph or whatever, be absurd. So I think you might've got to the core of why machine intelligence is not human intelligence.
That's a really interesting direction in which to take the question, because I think it carries me into thinking about the connection to what the difference is between a designed or engineered solution to a problem is and what you might call an evolved solution to a problem. But in a way, I to push back or nudge back in the original direction I was thinking, what you've latched onto is the idea that transfer learning, meaning trying to take something that you've learned to do one task very specifically and then kind of tweaking the parameters, but keeping it to some degree in the same domain area, you can see catastrophic failures. But I think a different question would be in that AlphaGo example, if you've made an algorithm, so to speak, or an input-output relationship that works that way, and it is extremely optimized for something, maybe it's not going to be good at playing Go on a different shaped board. But is there something else that it might be better at than if you hadn't optimized it for what you were trying to get it to do well? So I'm thinking more in terms of the evolutionary spandrels kind of story, where if you're a bird and you have wings, then maybe you'll be better at shading the water where you fish or something than if you were a random rearrangement of your constituent parts. Or, you know, you certainly wouldn't think of an automobile as being, you know, a garden planting setting where you'd fill it with dirt and put, you know, your vegetables in it, but you could do that because you can fill it up and open the windows. Like, you can find new purposes for things that have function. And the reason I partly am, I'm propelled into this I heard a talk a long time ago when I was a postdoc at Princeton by Sal Torquato about how, at least with regard to much simpler kind of many-body optimization problems, you can find examples of this where you're trying to optimize the packing of some spheres or some objects or whatever, and you have some criterion by which you optimize it, and then you find it's also optimal for something else that seems different. And it seems significant to the question to me when talking about lifelike self-organization, because what I have become interested in is physical arguments for why the physics of some many-body driven system is optimizing something about its relationship to the environment. And then the question is, what kind of a flexible toolbox that might provide? Could you repurpose the thing that you discovered that was good at one thing so that it turns out there's more than one thing that it's good at?
So my intuition, which is not worth a great deal, but let's say, would be that it sort of depends on the dimensionality of the optimization. Because what makes alpha zero so bad when you slightly perturb the task is that so many parameters have been recruited to fit the task. And I suspect that when you think about, yeah, you gave the example of bird wings for flight versus presumably an origin in thermoregulation, or at least that's the story I learned. It feels closer to the scalar end, right, than the vector end. That, you know, a hammer is just a bit, it's sort of like a bit of mass that you can use, right, to generate some momentum. And the perhaps that's the key, that transfer works quite well when the adjacent functions are both relatively low dimensional.
Would a modification of that be if you, let's say you tried to make something that worked well for 10 purposes, maybe it's more likely to work for 1,000 others. You know, that if you did try to build into it that it was multi-purpose, that maybe multi-purposeness is more generalizable in some sense.
Well, I think that makes a lot of sense. There's this nice work that's analogous to that, which is, you remember this early work that Bob May did on complexity and stability of ecosystems. So you write down these systems of differential equations, right? And you capture the interactions between species in this matrix, the community matrix. And Bob used random matrix theory to ask about spectral properties of this matrix. He said, well, is that system going to be stable if I just remove one element? So is the fixed point destabilized? And for a random matrix, the answer was yes. But if you don't do it that way, you don't just populate a random matrix, but allow it to evolve. So you sort of add rows and columns. Two species stabilize, third stabilize, fourth stabilize. Now when you perturb it, it's kind of heavy. It's much more robust. And it's exactly to your point that the evolutionary trajectory is the analog of being multifunctional. And so it, for whatever interesting reason, this is a robustness story, not a innovation story, which I think the one you're telling, but there is something interesting about evolution that, that makes generalization in some sense more likely. But again, I do want to make that point that it is interesting, isn't it, that the cultural evolution of machine learning algorithms doesn't have that property. And nowadays, of course, you use those same reinforcement learning rules to play Atari Pong and Adventure and Breakout. And so it does have a little bit of that character, but I'm not sure whether with each new puzzle, the time to asymptotic performance diminishes.
It seems like that's a thing that is starting to be a real topic for discussion in the machine learning field, that, you know, how do you take things to the next level? Like, it makes me think of a nice talk that Joshua Bengio gave at the last NeurIPS conference that was about causality and maybe, you know, I don't want to paraphrase too loosely and attribute things to him that maybe are not accurate, but at least what I remember getting out of it was that the more so that you're discovering rules that are generalizable about the world that you're trying to get your learner to learn, clearly the more you're going to be kind of robust to what you think of as these batch effects. Like the AlphaGo example you're presenting, the more you conceive of this narrow task in machine learning as being, I'm going to optimize the hell out of parameters, and I'm never going to kind of change the environment or change the world that the learner lives in at all. And it's one data distribution that it's working from, versus these kind of pockets of data distribution and then these kind of violent shifts from one to one place to another when a whole lot of things change, that the more you kind of are learning from data distributions how to explain every little pocket of data that you're getting as coming from some underlying set of causal rules, then maybe you're going to be able to deal with those same rules in a new setting, in a novel setting, and do okay.
Yeah, I think I guess the physical version of that is you're sort of learning these basic, the symmetries, you're learning right. laws, and not mm-hmm. The broken symmetries or the contingent accidents that get piled up on top of the true regularity. Yeah. I do know that's very difficult though to learn. I remember visiting Google Research once and they were trying to teach learning rules to identify isomers. So say different conformations of proteins that, mm-hmm. of course, the images they were using were crystallographic images, sort of three-dimensional images. And you take the same molecule, right, and rotate it, and it just couldn't classify. It was like a different molecule. Mm-hmm. And so they had to build into the algorithm an appreciation for rotational symmetry. Mm-hmm. Didn't learn the symmetry, which right. is what they love that idea, right, that everything is sort of from scratch, mm-hmm. ab initio everything, but it's not true. And I do wonder, so it gets to the origin of life issue, to what extent does life, by virtue of being part of the physical universe, do a better job of dealing with the universe by virtue of encoding in some strange, implicit, latent way the symmetry it's trying to model? Mm-hmm. Right? And I often wondered about that with respect to mind to matter. I mean, we are matter, right? Mm-hmm. We do live in a three-dimensional world. Perhaps that matters. Whereas the machine learning algorithms are sort of Turing mathematical abstractions, they're not embodied in a fundamental sense. So perhaps that's why, you know, it's the old argument for doing evolutionary robotics for AI as opposed to rule systems. Mm-hmm. They live in the world and the world matters, the physicality right. matters. So perhaps that is partly an answer to your question. A lot of the hidden puzzles that are not the puzzle being solved is just existing, you know? Yeah. And that gives you that generalization and transfer that you're after, so.
So that's one kind of thought. And then the other one is kind of more of a question of thinking ahead to the future. Whenever you get into these discussions about life on other planets and things, I think because we've been so excited as a species, let's say, or as a civilization for the last 100 years or so, about the idea of going and visiting other stars and other planets. And our imaginations have run very far ahead of where the technology has gone. It seems right now like, well, maybe, you know, give it a little more time and there'll be a whole lot else that we can do. So I'm curious if you could imagine pessimistically a scenario where 500 or 1,000 years from now, we can't leave our solar system, right? It's not happening. And there isn't actually progress on that score that everyone had heralded or anticipated, you know, and maybe that's not going to be the case, but supposing it were, how would people talk differently about the question of finding life elsewhere in the universe?
God, it's a hard one. I'm trying to think of a precedent. You know, certainly there are national histories that have been more insular and parochial, that have not expressed an interest in the rest of the world. One thinks of Japan up to a certain point in history before Major Perry got there and messed it all up, whatever. And I think that if we had never even got out of low Earth orbit, right? Let's say we'd never even reached the moon, right? Would we turn away from consideration of non-terrestrial life? God, it's such an interesting. Perhaps scientists would. I think that culture would not. I think that science is so economically driven. We are part of the military-industrial complex, despite believing that we're not. And whereas artists are less so. I mean, they're not as contaminated as we are. And if there was no evident utility, because you know as well as I do, right, that ultimately this scientific interest is because we want to extract rare earth metals from meteor debris on the surface of the moon, right? So, you know, and so there is a hidden behind the curtain, the Wizard of Oz here is the market, as far as I'm concerned. And so maybe scientists would move on to the next utilitarian endeavor, and artists would keep thinking about counterfactual realities. I don't know.
I guess part of what that may point to is that when you think about the dimensions of the human spirit that get tangled up in discussion of life beyond the earth where we live, it is living in an imaginary space that touches a lot of different kinds of stories that people tell. So there's clearly some kind of continuous spectrum between stories about aliens and stories about superheroes and stories about the gods and all these things that humankind doesn't seem likely to leave behind or give up on anytime soon.
So that, of course, perfect segue. Thank you, Jeremy. That takes me to the question for you. And I don't know if folks, Jeremy just wrote a very intriguing book that tries to square the circle, as far as I'm concerned, but is fascinating in the courage, I think, of the project. And namely, relate ideas from a more intuitive branch of physics, condensed matter physics, let's say, statistical physics, to the Tanakh, right, to the Pentateuch, or to ideas in the Old Testament, Hebrew Bible. And I want to make a few points, and allow me to do this because I want to get to a deep question here. We are talking about books, and we started with the Andromeda Strain and how narrative is a source of inspiration in science, even though science tries in many ways to escape from it, interestingly. But it is a form of causality. So here's my question. So in the 1940s, a rather famous Russian critic, Mikhail Bakhtin, who's a historian of the novel, was interested in where the novel came from and what the novel could do that the epic couldn't. And his point was that human experience, in particular subjective first-person experience, tends to not be very strong in the Iliad and the Odyssey and the Aeneas. It's not really a part of classical literature, but it's very much a part of the novel in the Renaissance. And he's looking primarily at the early 17th century and things like Don Quixote. It's full of that, right? And so the novel emerged as this window into subjective reality that was clearer than the window of the epic. Okay, point one. You, in your book, use a literary form, or choose a literary form, the religious, the eschatological narrative. It's not just a narrative, it's not just the epic, it's a supernatural narrative, which is by most people considered to be immiscible with science, right? I mean, not to use a mathy term, orthogonal to science, but that's somehow a little bit too primitive for me. And the argument you make is a little bit like Bakhtin's argument for what the novel did, is that there are in myth narratives that refer to mechanisms and processes that have analogs in physical theory. So it gets back to what we said earlier, right? That we're embodied beings, right? So is that surprising? No. But you chose not to go with T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland, you know, Milton's Paradise Lost, or The Divine Comedy. You chose something else. And it's something else that I happen to know you are existentially deeply interested in. Mm-hmm. So I think two questions. One is, if you were really just trying to explicate deep physical concepts in a more widely circulating language, why not take the movies of James Cameron, right? Why not take The Wasteland, you know? Why take the Tanakh? And secondly, once you've answered that, what is your position on the reconciliation of science and religion? And we can talk about that more broadly, because that's a big question. Sure. You know? But somehow that is in the book, and I think we have to address it.
Yeah, no, I think those are the right kind of questions to be asking about the book. Or I mean, it's certainly a very central aspect of how it all got built together. Just to maybe provide a little context, I can describe that. I guess word by word, most of the book is about physics. Each chapter is mostly an attempt to explain a piece of the evolution of a scientific argument, where you have to kind of learn how to think about statistical mechanics, classical statistical mechanics, and get all the tools you need to assemble the idea of how certain kinds of life, like self-organization, have a rigorous physical way that you could try to think about them. But then the wrapping, or let's say the architecture of how this is all laid out, I chose to be one where, aside from the introduction and the ending, which are both a bit more like essays, each chapter is given a title and theme that comes from a particular passage in the Hebrew Bible, which is this moment when Moses encounters God at the burning bush before he leads the Hebrews out of Egypt. And then there's an epilogue for each chapter where there's a return to that title theme and kind of an examination of it in a more kind of exegetical way. And then in between is most of the substance, which is the discussion of the physics that doesn't really traffic in the language of religious texts and trying to get things out of them. And so in a narrow sense, the reason that I wrote it this way was severalfold. I think first of all, I am conscious of the fact that when you talk about what life is and where it comes from, the discussion is not going to stay within the confines of what you think of as, we are just interested as dispassionate natural scientists in explaining different phenomena of the world, and let's have a discussion about that. People are too excited by the question of what life is and where it's from, you know, which speaks to, I think, a lot of the motivation in this whole series. You know, why is it that people write fiction more often about alien life or alien intelligence than they might write fiction about the fractional quantum Hall effect or something like that? You know, it's about things that inspire human interest of a very broad range of kinds. And so given that I'm writing a book for lots of people to read and maybe learn something from, I just can't help but feel conscious that it's going to be part of a larger discussion. And it's not a discussion that I'm uninterested in myself or have nothing to say about. And so I kind of just wanted to put my cards on the table. And rather than write a book that says, let me just talk about the physics, and then if someone picks it up and runs with a ball in a different direction, I have nothing to do with that. Or rather than be coy and sort of surreptitious in how I inject my editorial position or something into how it all unfolds, I want to just be very explicit and say, look, I'm aware this broader discussion exists. And so let me find a way of wrapping things in a commentary about that makes sense to me. And then it's very much my personal stamp or the direction I'm coming from. When I'm engaging with those kinds of questions and those themes, I do care about what's in the Hebrew Bible specifically, because that's a personal commitment. And I understand that it's not everyone's personal commitment, but so I'm writing the book, so I'll write it that way. But then also, I think what I was really gratified to discover was that if I'm going to go into the text of the Hebrew Bible and treat it like I should be able to find commentaries in it on whatever I think it's important for people to talk about on the subject matter, you know, what is life and where it comes from, what does it mean? That if there is an existential question there, it should have something to say about it. I was gratified to discover that it really seemed to me like there was a particular passage that was engaged with this question in an interesting way. And also as a bonus, it suddenly seemed to me like the kind of talismans that were presented there for discussion even maybe helped to some degree to bring a technical discussion more into the everyday experience of the human being, because the Hebrew Bible is very much addressed to the experience of individuals as they see or perceive the world in an unfiltered way, not with telescopes and microscopes and whatever else, but just as, you know, you trudge through the mud, or, you know, you watch the snow blow around in the wind or whatever else. That's how, or for that matter, as you experience yourself as a living physical being, right? And see parts of yourself fall off of you and stop being alive and start seeming like the dust of the earth. You know, those kinds of contemplations are the language that the text of the Hebrew Bible is really most trying to speak in when talking to someone about these kinds of questions. Basically, I think the important thing to me is that if I'm going to try to weigh in on this kind of a subject and talk about the science, I am also curious, and I also think it's important to include in the discussion a kind of an answer to the existential angst that naturally comes out of this way of thinking about life. Because if you look at life and yourself and other people as a physicist and say, oh, well, it's just particles banging into other particles, then what's the difference between me and the table that I'm sitting at, right? You know, are we all just collections of atoms? And is the meaning of the distinction that we tend to recognize socially an arbitrary and therefore not fundamental one? And if that's true, then does that mean that, you know, it's kind of antiquated to think that murder is wrong? You know, you can very quickly get into these lines of thought that, you know, usually don't leave the kind of university discussion section kind of setting where people say crazy things and then they go back to hopefully trying to behave like moral beings. But the stakes are real, because this discussion between Moses and God is about liberating the Hebrew slaves from Egypt. And Pharaoh in Egypt might have had a much easier time enslaving people and working them to death when he might have viewed them no differently than bricks in the pyramids that he was building, right? It's all just material that I can manipulate as a god on earth. So there are times and places where the stakes of this question are extremely high and really foundational to whole civilizations. So it seemed like that needs to be part of the discussion. I shouldn't pretend that it can be separated, so I'll put it out there and start the conversation.
No, it's there are so many things to say about it. The one thing that came to mind was that in book form, mingling these two worlds has a long history. If you think about Galileo, Dialogue Concerning the Two World Systems. Mm-hmm. So this is beginning of the 17th century, and it's the Ptolemaic versus Copernican debate. And Galileo wrote it as a Socratic dialogue, three characters. It's a very literary exercise, and it's funny, right? It's interesting, it's compelling as a human narrative, but the ideas that are being presented are scientific ones, and Galileo is a great hero. Most people will think the earlier Galileo, Sidereus Nuncius, right? It's basically filled with beautiful pictures of the moon. And but I think that something has been lost, in fact, in scientific writing. And I commend you for bringing it back in, and others do it, perhaps not as overtly. You know, we are narrative beings. We live in history. We live in myth, you know. And science connects directly to it. And it's strange how we make an effort to sterilize or cauterize that boundary. So now, okay, having said that though, there is still this question that I have, which is, what would constitute a complete theory for the origin of life. And are you saying, in a sense, that, which I probably would agree with, I've always thought it was one of the great disappointments, in a sense. If someone were to perform an experiment tomorrow and say, I've done it, I've created a replicator that's metabolically powered in a test tube. And I think you and I would just roll our eyes. I mean, I don't mean to be, it would, yeah, of course you have. I mean, because, you know, after decades of engineering, starting with Miller-Urey, you've done it, it's ingenious, but I don't think it's told us something new about life. Life isn't just that, right? Life is much more interesting than that. And there are other principles that we don't discuss in our papers that are maybe would be considered more metaphysical. Now, I'm an atheist, right? I'm not a religious person, but I'm still very interested in concepts of life that go beyond stable replicators with an ATP energy source. And I'm wondering about that. I mean, should this whole science of the origin of life stop at the Andromeda strain, which is this little, you know, crystal lattice that copies itself and destroys everything it lands on? Or should it actually consider extending into culture, which is certainly what Schrodinger meant in the concluding chapters of What is Life? So cultural evolution is an extension of biological evolution in some sense. What are your thoughts on the bigger origin of life question, not just the chemistry of replicating matter in the lab?
Yeah, well, I think that partly this pertains to something you referred to earlier, which is the kind of the grand question of whether people are right when they see, let's say, scientific reasoning and biblical religion as being totally at loggerheads, and you kind of have to pick one or the other. And I think part of what this comes down to is the question of whether when we're quote unquote done, or even whether as we make, you know, better and better progress in understanding and describing the world and what it is and how it works, are we going to have one language at the end in which we capture it all, or are we going to need more than one? And interestingly, this is something that the Hebrew Bible itself is interested in as a topic for discussion. You know, the Tower of Babel, the idea of a society that has one language and that they're trying to build a tower into the heavens, and it contains this notion of we'll eventually kind of have the divine perspective on everything. That is kind of laughed at by the text. You know, that it describes how God descends to the tower because, you know, they never reached nearly as high, and gives them multiple languages, and they don't continue in that same enterprise. And I think sometimes we think of that as kind of like a punishment or a he's just kind of foiling their plot, but it also is a gift, right? Multiple languages we may be also able to see as kind of a positive imperative, because we're not really going to get far enough in as many directions as we could if we restrict ourselves to one way of talking. And I think that may, getting to your very interesting point about Galileo and dialogues, that may be part of the origin of what in the present day seems like such an irresolvable schism between talking about the Bible or, you know, other religious ideas and taking them seriously versus, you know, talking about the world as scientists do. Because almost, it's almost the case that everyone who lines up along that line of scrimmage will, you know, they both are laboring under the same false premise that at the end, there will be only one way of talking standing. And that is where we end up running into trouble, because you can do science and talk about the past through that lens, and you'll come up with analysis of cosmic microwave background radiation and geology and everything else that's talking to you about, you know, billions of years and the grand scope of and the sweep of prehistory and how you can imagine planets and life, you know, might have emerged. And then you go and you look in the first pages of the book of Genesis, and that's not what it's saying, seemingly, if you compare them as though they're one language. And you say, okay, so one of these is true, one of these is false. I don't think that was the original intended use of these ways of talking about the world. And I think there's a, it wasn't necessarily meant to be assumed to be the case that this is going to be the only way of telling about the past that has any validity. And in fact, you could almost say in the 7 days of creation that you're sort of getting tweaked on the nose with how you have to realize this is different. This is a different way of talking. You know, if you're a person even thousands of years ago and you're told there were plants on day three and the sun came on day four. So, you know, we know that plants need the sun, and that's not necessarily such an enormous achievement of modern science to have realized that about what plants need. So if the text is pushing that under your nose, it's kind of saying to you, maybe the chronology here is a little scrambled. Also, we know how difficult or easy it is to build big things. And 7 days seems rather a short period of time, or even really six, because the seventh day is for rest, right? So obviously you could say, oh, well, that's meant to demonstrate God's great and awesome power. Well, maybe, and partly, but it could also be that at the same time, it's kind of making the point, when you talk about the world in a way that pushes the role of the world's creator front and center, and you use a language that privileges that aspect, like the verbs of what he's doing in the account, it's going to come out sounding like 6 days. But that's not 6 days measured as 24 hours, which are your rotations of the earth as it faces the sun, et cetera, right? It's a question of how the text uses the word that you have to look at very carefully before you decide how you translate it. But I think it's the important starting point, right? Are we really claiming that there's only one way of talking that will succeed at the end or not? And I think people like Galileo, the further you go back in time, brilliant people who did think scientifically about the world, it wasn't just that they also got a good religious brainwashing and so they couldn't totally let go of it. It was also that I think they probably would have found many of the scientistic arguments against religion today kind of laughable because they would have seemed like a very rookie category mistake in understanding, you know, how the text, or methodological error in how the text is meant to be read. So Galileo was writing in Socratic dialogue because he came from a time that appreciated much better that when people like Plato or whoever were using that medium to make a point, it's because they understood that language, and that medium allows you to make a point in different ways than you can make it with a set of equations or with a very dry didactic and linear logical argument.
You know, it's interesting. I've always thought that the two deepest contributions of complexity science as it matures would be, one, the focus on universality, right? That is, that there are substrate independent laws and regularities that come out of, say, many body dynamics or what have you. And the second would be to create space for fundamentally different languages or effective theories, and why they exist. Sort of a fancy renormalization theory that would say psychological language is not reducible to cognitive science, which is not reducible to neuroscience, which is not reducible to cell biology, etc., down to, you know, whatever, some weird quantum theory. And what Dan Dennett calls greedy reductionism is such a problem and is so naive and boring, actually, that it has to be countered with another kind of theory that gives space for the diversity of language. And it's interesting, by the way, Jeremy, the examples I always use, because we always talk about things like, you know, oh, fear response. Well, there's this hormone, right, that gets in. And some that satisfies certain people for reasons that are beyond me. But let's take a more interesting example, which is mathematical proof, deduction. If you're proving a theorem using deduction, there's no physicist on the planet who would say, well, what we really need to do is sort of put that thing in a particle collider because we need to understand the underlying physics of proof. Everyone understands perfectly well that you prove theorems in mathematics using mathematics, not using something below it. And it's very funny because I don't know why that just isn't more widely appreciated, because for most people, I would say, explanation consists in atomization, right? If I'm interested in level N, understanding is always N minus one. But we know that's not true in mathematics. So what's the problem? And it's not true in poetry, right? And it's not true in literature. And presumably it's not true in mythic or supernatural language. And one thing I would like to understand scientifically is when that's true and when it's not. Could we actually have a science of that, that would actually give breathing room to diversity? Because I think you're right. Reductionism is really totalitarianism in disguise.
Yeah. And I, on the one hand, we always want to give the value of reductionism its due, certainly within the scientific context, where when there is an opportunity to realize that Maxwell's equations are one set of things that you can now use to explain a whole bunch of different stuff together, and you can talk about light, and you can talk about magnets, and you can talk about circuits, and they're not the same thing, but there's one tent where you can fit it all into a parsimonious set of equations or ideas. When that opportunity presents itself, you want to grab onto it, because there's a lot that can be gained from that in predictive power and in simplification of your representation of the world. And so one has to understand why science develops kind of a culture where this becomes the desired goal. But then clearly what becomes naive about it is to imagine that when we're done, we'll have completely finished all of the atomization, as you put it, and there won't be any need any longer for different effective levels of description, because the world at the end of the day is, you know, heterogeneous in terms of how much it yields to that. Some aspects of it yield very nicely, and others really, there's been no progress whatsoever from the onward march of modern science for centuries in pushing back the horizon even a little bit and saying, oh yeah, now we have an atomistic or reductive description of, how to predict how a story plays out when two people are in love and, you know, then one of them goes far away and blah, blah, blah. You know, and that, as you say, literature, you could study much more effectively what happens to people and how they behave. We're not closer because we have more digits on measuring the fine structure constant or something like that.
So this, just to bring us full circle to life itself, and this is where there is this trace, perhaps even in your work, and I want to, even though you've done this extraordinary thing, which is bind the mythic and the molecular in some sense, which is that when it comes to life, there's one origin. So we've argued recently, actually, that there are multiple, and life can come from non-life, but life could also come from life. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, if the principles are dominant, that is inference, replication, and so forth, then of course we could build digitally life forms that have all of those. I don't see why not. And they are made by us. That's a second origin, or maybe a third origin, or whom. And why, when it comes to life, which I think would lend itself very well to this multiple language perspective, that it should be articulated perhaps every level of life in its own language, actually. Have we been so resistant, and is it so dominated by the molecular? Why is it seems to me an odd case of reductionism at play.
Yeah, well, to some degree, I think that is just because of recent history, and it's probably about, it's ripe to change in a sense, because in the 20th century, you know, at the beginning of the 20th century, to a first approximation, there was virtually nothing that could be said about how life worked that was much, much smaller than what you could observe in a light microscope of, you know, what cells were doing, right? So maybe people had started to purify different chemical activities and they could sort of start to see what happened when you poured this on that. But it was a really very early and nascent science. And then the second half of the 20th century, there was this huge explosion of information about, you know, DNA and RNA and proteins and everything else that you can now measure, and just the possibility for the first time of seeing how physics that had helped us to understand atoms and molecules could actually be the reasons that pieces of living things were doing what they were doing, that it wasn't that you needed some vitalistic, completely different essence to explain what was happening. And now we're, I think, maturing to the point where we can just keep making more and more and more data of different kinds. And we can look at in single cells, which RNAs and proteins are being expressed, and, you know, and we can get higher and higher in dimensional data and more and more and more granular. And we're now in this glut of these data and realizing, well, actually, in order to start telling what's going on, we have to zoom back out and find systematic ways of doing that, because it becomes meaningless, you know, if someone just gives you a petabyte of numbers and says, okay, this is life, how could you even tell the difference between that and the vibrational states of the atoms in your table? What would be different? What would you look for? So I think that as especially biology gets into the big data realm and it intersects with machine learning, and this is a topic I'm currently keenly very interested in, scientifically and professionally, I think you start to need to say, now we're looking for the ways of systematically discovering the effective descriptions that are going to be most powerfully predictive. And so we'll be pushed out from the granularity. Even if we can generate more and more granularity, we're going to need methods that can help us to detect the collective features that are the most interesting.
Yeah, is are you suggesting that artificial intelligence is the new path to artificial life?
Well, I guess I was talking for the moment more about if you're trying to make predictive sense of actual life that you already have examples of, you're being forced in the direction of not being reductive or mechanistic, but really maybe trying to use machine learning methods to find for you that which is more predictable or more mechanistic within what seems at first like a hopeless mess when you look at it quantitatively. And I think that maybe the other side of that coin, if you're talking about now, how would you detect life likeness of different kinds in matter where, you know, you haven't yet been looking for it in the right way, or how would you cultivate certain kinds of life likeness? It may be that quantification is a part of how you develop really good control in that context, but it probably also will be the case that you'll end up with a certain amount of non-interpretability of aspects of the models that you use to handle that quantification, right? That you'll train models to detect things for you that you have started to realize are kind of the qualitative questions that need to be asked in order to tell whether you're moving things in the right direction or not. So it's a harder thing to now ask, you know, how do you build something that's like life, but is sufficiently different that you can call it a real achievement, and it's not just an imitation of what we already know.
It's interesting. I think there's certainly been something I've been interested in, which is the intersection between some of these fundamental questions about life and fundamental questions about consciousness and intelligence, because just some recent work with Chris Kempes, where we've been talking about life the way that David Marr talked about cognition, right? So Marr had this hierarchical view that to describe any information processing system, you have to worry about materials, neurons and such like. You have to worry about functions. What's it doing? What are you doing when you look at something? So physical, optical calculation, right? And then bridging those two, the function and the materials, are the algorithms. And any information processing system is susceptible to description in those three terms. In the case where the mapping is unique between levels, right? There is only one realization in material of a function, which is sort of the unstated premise of much of origin of life research, right? It has to happen this way, right? Then fair enough. But if, as probably you are, I'm a functionalist, which is a concept borrowed from theory of mind to apply to origin of life, then it's really the principle-centric perspective, right? That there are algorithms, if you like, or functions that are realized in materially different ways, but we care about them, right?
Yeah.
Not so much about the material. But now this takes us to the other neurocognitive computational perspective, which is Alan Turing. So remember, the reason why Alan Turing invented the Turing test or the imitation game was to circumvent materialism. Why he did it. He actually, there's a famous quote where he said, "I don't care if the brain is the consistency of cold porridge." That was, you know, that I don't care. The question is, can it convince me that it's thinking, hence the imitation game. And it does raise this question. I think it's what you're saying. You're doing a Turing on the problem. You're saying, I'm going to try and invent machine learning tools that apply a Turing test to life. And the data will be so messy that we'll have to do it this way, right? So we won't test the machine. The machine will test whatever the data. So I'm just wondering, is that where you're headed, where we could sort of say, these are the five things we're looking for? They're hard to find, but if we find them, then we get the FDA stamp of approval and say, life.
There's a paper that I was a part of that was in ICML this past summer that was about using a machine learning technique called an autoencoder to study what we already had, which was an example of what we would call lifelike complexity that self-organized in a simple simulation of a physical system. So the idea was that you had a bunch of different bits that were kind of flipping on and off, and they were behaving like simple physical particles that exerted forces on each other that made them flip up and down, so a spin glass. And then you hit that with barcoded forces so that there are these particular forces on each atom that are trying to flip this one up and that one down, et cetera. But you only use a limited number of barcodes to hit the system over time. So you put one set of forces, you switch again, but you keep like a certain number of cards in your deck and you only use those barcodes. So if someone didn't look too closely, the forcing from the environment on that system would look kind of random. It would just look like noise because they'd be each a random barcode. But actually over enough time, the fact that you're only using certain random barcodes implies a set of correlations that are specific to that subset of random barcodes. And so the system's rate of energy absorption goes down over time because it learns basically to be in a state that's finely tuned to that way of forcing the system. And then if you change to a different deck of cards, right, a different set of barcodes that are from the same family of completely random barcodes, the energy absorption spikes and then eventually settles back down again as it learns the new environment. So there's this sense in which there's kind of a self-organized novelty detection or pattern recognition that you get from very primitive physics in the actual pieces of the system that are banging into each other and changing their state. So what we were interested in there is, can we use an autoencoder, which is a machine learning method using neural networks to try to detect lower dimensionality to study what is happening in that system? So you have many degrees of freedom, many variables describing the state of your system, but in a sense, if the system is in a particular state that's good at lowering its energy absorption for a particular random pattern, then it must actually be in a kind of exceptional state and not a randomly selected state, which means that even though, let's say it's described by, I don't know, 1,000 variables, that there should be some sense in which it's in a lower than 1,000 dimensional space because it's in some kind of specialized state that's a slice of that whole space of possibilities. And that's what autoencoders are good at detecting, kind of hidden lower dimensionality in high dimensional data. And so you can take your self-organized system where it happens to be the case that you have found an externally measurable thermodynamic signature of specialness, which is this energy absorption. And then you can go and just put an autoencoder on it and see whether the two phenomena line up. And indeed, you can detect the lower dimensionality that corresponds to that behavior. But one of the things that points to is that now maybe you could use an autoencoder on some matter where, you know, you didn't have any reason a priori to think it was in a particularly non-random arrangement. And I think the reason that's significant is because there's a lot of aspects of lifelikeness that involve certain kinds of exceptionality to your arrangement. But unless you know how to look for it, you might miss it. So I think that we do have tools now that we didn't used to have for going into systems and trying to be, you know, more precise about what we mean about what kind of complex, fine-tuned, exceptional behavior we're seeing and that we might have previously not noticed or missed. And that could be part of, you know, a strategy for looking for lifelikeness. I don't think it solves the problem for you. I think the autoencoder won't tell you what's life and what isn't, but it's kind of a tool in your tool belt.
No, it gets at one element of intelligent systems or living systems, which is the representational the compact representation of the regularities in the environment. So it's discovering the correlations in your data and encoding them through the bottleneck. And it's, and I would, I think, yeah, Murray Gell-Mann used to call those the schema. I think that's fundamentally, I would argue, I've called this the reflection principle, what natural selection does. We measure it with mutual information, right? It allows a system to encode regular repeated elements of the environment. To take that towards life, I think we'd want to add to that some predictive or instrumental control over the world, right? Because that's just, I would say, one fascinating element of a living or intelligent system, but it's not enough, because I think that this weird property of agency is critical. And that has a kind of a future orientation, not just a past-based compression, which is what we've discovered.
Indeed.
Yeah. So Jeremy, after that long meandering conversation, which is the best kind of conversation, I want to get back to this final career question for you, actually, which has to do with writing a book. Unfortunately, we live in communities where our contributions are measured in shards. and you've done this thing, which is to write a book. And I, as Michael Crichton did, you know, that's inspired this whole series, which is a, and I'm just wondering, just in brief, was that an enjoyable experience for you to put all of your thoughts in one place? And what's different from writing a paper?
It definitely is different than writing a paper. And I think that when I finally saw it in hardcover, I was amazed at how small it was. And I could never imagine writing a longer one, or at least the amount of effort it took. Maybe I'm not good at writing long books, but it was definitely gratifying to have written a book. I think writing one, certainly having the stamina to write that much when what I'm usually used to writing is scientific papers and essays and things that are shorter, definitely took some increase in my respiratory capacity or something along those lines. But I feel pretty satisfied that I've gotten to make the point kind of thoroughly, because I think it is sometimes hard to talk about the arc of a long argument when you have to do it in the kind of increments that scientific papers usually demand. And I do think that talking through all the different ingredients to how you get something you might call lifelike self-organization, you know, from basic physical principles, there are a number of different steps that it's worth considering carefully. And so I certainly am glad to have gotten the opportunity to do that. And I think the other thing, you know, referencing some other things we got to in this discussion, is that what was satisfying to me is, you know, getting back again to what you talked about as this question of the orthogonality or immiscibility of science and religion. I could write a whole other book about that. And in some ways, you know, that's something where it's easier to fill pages and pages because it's more of a kind of philosophical argument that needs to be laid out. And I do think there's a lot to be said there. I think, for example, that the Hebrew Bible knows very much what it is to reason scientifically about the natural world. And it explores that idea and narrative in what I have found to be profound detail and with great understanding of what you can figure out about the world that way and what its limitations are. So maybe one day I will be favored to have the chance to write a book about that topic or something like it. But with this one, I think what was really important to me was just to kind of show by example that it's possible to come to each subject together without sacrificing intellectual depth in either, or without kind of compromising one's attitude about how one views or approaches understanding the world through these different lenses, and just to demonstrate that you can do both and start a discussion that way and not easily be dismissed. I understand that it's not maybe, you know, an immediately convincing or compelling result to whoever might be reading it. But I think that at least it's hard to dismiss it without a long conversation. And that hopefully is the beginning of making the point that rather than talking about you have to pick one and you know everyone who stands on one or the other side of the line is going to say the other one is wrong, perhaps there's a way of coming with enough open-mindedness and seriousness to the discussion that you can do both really well at once. And if so, that we can come to new understandings that way.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Jeremy. Wonderful.
Thank you.
And hope to see you soon.
Pleasure talking to you, David. Thanks. Take care.
Well, that was fun.
I enjoyed it very much.
Yeah, no, it's going to be very interesting. And we've got, I got this wonderful letter that I sent to Caitlin just the other day. Is I don't know who it is, but he wrote a short note saying, thank you so much for the series and I love it. And here's a short story for you.